Hi everyone. Is the mic on? Yes. So, welcome to my talk. And yeah, Engie Vikings, it's almost done for today. So, yeah. But I will have a talk about Take a Snapshot, and I will first introduce myself. So, I'm Bo van der Steenen. It was almost correct. I currently work for a Swiss company. I just moved to Switzerland as a senior software engineer. We take pictures with drones, transform them to 3D images, so like inspections can measure distances on it. I'm also a firefighter, and recently I also joined the Swiss firefighters, so it's quite cool. I'm active on Medium, so now and then I post an article of some experiences in the programming field. I have also a Twitter account, so you can start following me if you want. And I have two nice children from 8 and 5 years old. But we're gonna talk about snapshots. So a snapshot, what's a snapshot? It's like a moment. You can compare it to the real life. For example, you have that schematic on the whiteboard that you need to draw over for learning, and afterwards you get a test of it, you need to reproduce something. Or it can be also a photo of a certain moment. Like yesterday I went to Copenhagen, I saw the mermaid, but the mermaid will never change. Also, for example, the first time your kid plays soccer, that's only one moment, so it's a snapshot of life. But how can we compare it for a code? We can say we will take a snapshot of a component. And what does that mean? We have, for example, this small code that renders a list of images in a certain grid, and then we have like this. We have 10 images getting from somewhere, and we have a nice grid. If I do this code each time again with 10 images, then I will get the same result. And I get also the same HTML code. I did that just a picture of my HTML code. It's a bit longer, but it's a snapshot. Next, we can also have a snapshot of a block of code. Yeah, what does that mean? We have, for example, this list that creates the images, and at the end, we have a result. Again, if our total images are 10, then we get something like this. This never changes. It's always the same. So we can do it with tests also. For example, we have a test case. We render our UI component and we test it against the snapshot of HTML code. So how do we do it with Jasmine? With Jasmine, we will do it like this. It's just the snapshot, it's just the code that we get from our NG. Generate a new project, we filter out the title, and we get equal it to a string. But is this what we really want? If we want to test each case, we have a lot of lines of code. We can't forget code to test, because if we add some functionality, we need to write these tests. Also, our test will not fail if we add some additional code. It's hard to define all test cases, and I really don't want to write all this HTML myself. And you don't get a nice feedback for now. So, we can skip tests. Yeah. Because it's hard to maintain. We should skip them. But yeah, what? We have end-to-end tests. We run Cypress. Cypress is cool. We use it also on our project. But it's not the same. Here, we're talking about end-to-end tests. Not about end-to-end tests. Sorry, for Cypress, we use end-to-end tests. But here, we talk about unit tests. So what's the difference between both? A unit test, you can see it's small. It's easy to test. It's, for example, a function. It can be a class. It can be a complex algorithm. But it's a unit of your code. It can be also like 3 methods that we use that are private to simplify our code. For example, we can add something. That's not an end-to-end test because we don't have something visual to test this. That's just some business logic. On the other hand, we have our end-to-end test. For example, we can take screenshots to give feedback. It's the entire application. We can or run it against a mock backend or run it against a real backend. We will test flows. Typical, you have your login screen, you make your login, and you check that something has been added to your cookies or session storage, whatever. And you can do it with Protractor, Cypress, and there are still other tools to do that. So today we will talk about unit tests, the smart part of code that we want to test because we want to have a better feeling. But okay, wait, testing is hard. Yes, testing is hard. You have maybe a hard time to set up, although with the Angular CLI it's easier. We need to define some mock data, and we need to maintain it. Also, if you look at the HTML code or like that array that we generated, we need to maintain our tests, and the business is against us and say, oh, wait, you need to deliver now. We have defined the deadline. We want to see something. Okay. But at the end, that will return in a higher cost. If we don't test our code and we break something, then we will break our code, and then we need to figure out why it was broken. Also, you can see it as a great documentation for your code. Because if we are honest to ourselves, if we have like that UA ticket, yeah, we don't update it if we change something or we don't update our documentation. And if you want to go test-driven, then it will have an improvement of your quality because you think before your tests. So, I have a solution for it. I don't have a solution for all of your problems, but maybe for this problem. It's Jest. It's built by Facebook on top of the JS DOM, so it doesn't use Chrome. So, less problem on, for example, continuous integration tools like Jenkins. But okay, why should we use it? Because testing is hard. Yeah. It's fast. It runs parallel. Each test part is unique. It runs on its own. And Jest also runs first the failed tests. So it reorders your test. If you have fast tests, this one will be also run after your failed test. It requires zero configuration. If you want to set up a project, it's almost no configuration. All tests are isolated. So in a sandbox, they run on their own. You can also take benefits of snapshots. So that means the HTML code or the code block I show you, it's nice. And also, it has a nice error reporting. If you know the Jasmine error reporting, it's quite hard to debug something. But for Jest, it's nice. First of all, we will talk a bit about this zero configuration for an Angular project. Okay. It's not nothing to do, but 2 minutes of work, and you are done. I have also a blog article on it. I've put the link so you don't need to write everything now. So first of all, we will remove the dependencies that we don't use anymore. But we need to pay a bit attention on it. If we remove it directly, and we have, for example, a mono repo, and we only want to replace one library by Jest, yeah, then we need to wait a bit to remove it. Otherwise, our other tests will break. Then we just add Jest and the Angular Builder Jest, yes? Jest can work out of the box with the Angular Builder, so we will run it from our ng commands. Then we replace a bit our tsconfig file, we add our module resolution to CommonJS and our types to Jest, because otherwise we will have failures in our TS TypeScript or in our ID because they want to use the old type descriptions of Jasmine. Pay attention to do this for each of your library or each of your application if you have a multi-library, a mono repo. Then we need to change a few lines in our AngularJSON. We say, okay, we want to use, instead of this builder, we want to use Angular builders, of course, and it will be Jest. We can add some parameters. For example, we don't want to use caching. We want to use this or that reporter. And then we do it again for each of our applications and libraries. If you use NX, then you can choose between Jest and Karma, so you don't need to configure it. It comes out of the box. And then we can simply run ng-test, like we are used to do. So you don't see it even that it's Jest. So this complete configuration has already set it up. We can also run ng-test --coverage, and we get a nice report. We get our code coverage report. So that was it for setting up. This is almost zero configuration. Okay, if you want to have mappings in your TS file, and so you need to do a bit more work, but a basic configuration is set it up in no time. And then we go back to our snapshot part. So again, we have this example. We have our code rendered. If we look into our components, we see that we can set the total images, depending maybe on a service, or we want to add a random number because it's a dumb component, and we can set this number. So typically, we will write a test component.totalImages equals 10, and then we will run the tag changes because we want to, our HTML to be rendered. And then one line, we can expect that this fixture, so this rendered HTML, to match a snapshot. But okay, if we put it like this in our code, against what it will be compared, we don't know. We want to be compared to something like this, and against, I don't want to write this complete code. So what? It does just create just the snapshot if it doesn't exist yet. It adds an additional folder to your process, to your folder structure. It takes over the name of your component, for example, and it does just add snap. If we look in how this file looks like, it looks like something like this. It's readable. It uses your describes and your its to compose a title for your snapshot. Then it adds the HTML, the rendered HTML, and it's readable because it's formatted with Prettier. So it's readable. So that means also you can review if it's the right output that has been generated. And now I want to change something. So I have my generated snapshot file. So I change something, I rerun my test, and then I get some nice representation that's readable. If you have such a representation in Jasmine, it's not so readable. I see exactly on which line the grid list has been changed to high I changed to. So nice feedback. So what we already learned about Jest, it creates the snapshot if it doesn't exist, it compares the expectation to the stored snapshot, and it performs a nice difference between both snapshots. But now I've changed something, and that's really the truth, because I needed to change my component. You can just easily update the snapshot when you did a refactor of your code, which ng-test-u. Minus u stands for update tests. So again, it's easy. I didn't need to change my snapshots manually, I could do it. One important thing is that you need to commit your snapshots, because if you run the continuous integration tool, then it needs to have something to compare against. And you generated that snapshot, so you agree on it. Also, the other developers can review that snapshot. They can see, okay, has the snapshot changed? Should it be changed? Because it can be hard if, yeah, like for example, 10 snapshots has been changed in your code, it can be hard. And it can be not relevant for what you want to do. But we can, components, maybe you know already about it, but you can also test other things with snapshots. So you can also test this code. This is a function that returns again an array of images, so that produce some data. If I write my test, I expect that the list images 3,2 match a snapshot. My snapshot will be generated. Again, something very readable for us. It's just an array with objects. It's formatted. It has the calls. And this, if I give 10 as an input, it will always remain this output. So my test will stay the same, and I didn't need to write this array of objects. Next, we can also use it for RxJS tests. I don't know who is familiar with testing RxJS code. Probably some of you, or maybe not. I always use RxJS marbles for this. So I write, for example, this not really smart observable, but easy to understand. I have my source code, it's a BC, I get like three characters. I just add one to my position in the ASCII table, and then I format it again to a string. So I have my timeline where I submit my values, and I expect, of course, BCD. But what you can see in this test, if you are familiar with it, it's that it's one frame too late, my expect. So in this case, I expect that my test is failing. If I just run it with Jasmine again, I get something like this. This is maybe quite readable because it only consists of four frames, and it only consists of values BCD. But if you have the same thing with where you map your ABC to like real objects, you will not be able to read it anymore. So we will change one word in our test. We will just import the jest from RxJS marbles. And then the test remains the same, but the feedback is nice. Here I see exactly where my test is failing. It fails on frame 3. I get frame 3, but I expect that this will be returned on frame 2. Something is wrong. And this observable was quite easy to understand, but if you go test-driven, if you first draw your stream on a paper, you can already decide what's the input, what's the output. Then you start programming, and then you can see, okay, I'm doing the right operators on my stream. So these were two examples where we can use snapshots, but Jest offers also some globals. In Jasmine, we know also globals like describe and it and some others. So they are like pretty familiar in Jest. We have the after all, after each, before all, before each. It's the same as in Jasmine. But then we have also describe. And the special thing on describe, we have a describe each, a describe only each, skip each. Okay, that's special because I never saw this in Jasmine. On the other hand, we have also the test command. And the test, it's similar to it. If you don't want to use it, a test because you are familiar with it, it's perfectly normal. So let's take an example of the describe each because this feature is like really nice. I write my test. Describe each, I have an input 1,1. 5, 2. So I have, in fact, 3 test cases in this example. I want to list my images. Again, the same function of before, where I have a total elements and a maximum columns. The total elements will be taken the first element of the array, and the maximum columns will be the second element of the array. Again, if I do now expect list images to match a snapshot, I get something like this in my snapshot. So I get 3 tests. I get first a test with 3,2, then list images 5,2. So that means it creates like a loop of tests. In this case, it's maybe nothing special, but you have like functions that you have not a normal output that it will not increase one by one. Then you can have something like this, because you can use also the before each without a snapshot. You can do it like this. I do a sum of 2 values, and if I start reading this test, if I do 1 plus 1, it equals 2. I will try to, I'm on the wrong screen. If I do 1 plus 1, it's 2. If I do 1 plus 2, it's 3. 2 plus 1 is 3. And then I just say, I expect that my first value plus my second value equals the accepted result. So I can create amazing tests with a small amount of code. Because we all write like these tests that are like repetitive. So that's one solution you can use for it. Then we have another amazing feature. Before I was like always writing, if I didn't implement the test, I will let fail that test. But here you can like really say, I want to add a to-do. And then it comes in the output of your tests. You can say test.todo, add some testing, and then you have an additional line. So again, this has a nice feedback that you get from Jest. And one thing that's very important in testing, it's mock. we use this a lot. Or you are supposed to use it a lot if you do unit testing, because you want to have a predication of your input. You know what you put in, and you know what's coming out. But for example, if you test an Angular component or an Angular service, the services that are like inputted, yeah, there you need to mock out these functions because you want to predict what's coming out. If you have some business logic in another service, you don't want to test it in this service. So you need to mock some things. So, for example, we have this function. It just maps something and it gets some items and it calls a callback with the items. Again, I try to keep my examples a bit simple to understand. So, if I want to mock a callback, I can, for example, say my callback is mocked to just.function xtime2s. Okay, we have similar with Jasmine, but the only difference is like how you start mocking it out. And then I call my new list, I have these three values, and I do a mock callback. Then I can, first of all, count how many times this callback has been called. In this case, it's 3 times because I loop over my list and it's called 2 times. I can do it in 2 ways. I can just mock callback.mocks.calls.length, but for me, I prefer the second one because it's more readable to have been called times. Next, that we can test with which value that callback has been called. So the first time it should be called with 1, the second time with 2, the third time with 3, because it's defined as that in your list. So that means also if you have like a nice test that it's like really running on that test and you can define, okay, is it right that my service has been called with that value? Because I want, for example, send something to an Nginx store and I want to know that my dispatch has been called with this value. Okay, I will test it the second iteration that needs to be called with that value. Next, that's almost the same, but we can also ask what will be the return value of this mock callback. Maybe we don't really want to test it, but that can happen. Another thing we can do with this callback is just test it against a snapshot, and we get against our generated file, and we don't need to write all this code, because that's the output of our list. We know the mock callback will multiply by 2, so that's nice. And we have something else that we can perform with our mock. Here I just created a Viking mock. It doesn't do anything because if you print it out, it says undefined, which is quite logic because you didn't say anything. I can define what will be the first return value, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth. So in this case, if I print it out, I just get ng-viking as cool true true. So that means the first 5 iterations that this mock has been executed, it will return my value that I returned, and then at the end it will always return true in this case. So we can predict what we want to return on each moment. So again, if we start testing our units and we call multiple times the same service but with different values, we can predict what comes out of that service. And now I go to the part of some tips and tricks. Because all the things I showed with snapshots are quite cool, but you need to pay attention on it. First of all, test your documentation. Strive to have descriptive tests and or snapshots names, because the test will document your code. I was once on a project and I was like so happy that there were so many tests, because if I started editing something, I was like afraid that the code was broken because the documentation was bad, but the tests were so good. So if you have your test as your documentation, it's nice. Also, test logic. I've seen some projects where they told me, oh, I achieved 100% of test coverage. Okay, and what did you test? If I look to it, I changed something, but it doesn't break your test, so something went wrong in your 100% test coverage. So I don't care about how many percentage of unit tests you write, but in the company where I work, I like strive to have as much of tests that test logic. And what's logic? It's like a calculation, it's some business logic. It can be rendered components if you have like a lot of logic inside your component itself. Also, use the before each and use after each. Why? Because in most tests, you want to group some logic. And yeah, you can, one, repeat it, and then if you change something at your before each, where you normally should use before each, then your test can fail, and then you need to start edit it on each line. So use before each. Like, for example, for Angular, it's done by default for setting up a service or a component in your tests, but probably you can add some more things like default values. Also, create snapshots as code. What we mean with that is review them, make them part of the review process. If you create a pull request with snapshots, take a look at the snapshot. It can be that your snapshot is wrong or you don't expect it. Because again, I worked in a company, I did a project for them, and like on everything they run ng test minus u, and then okay, I update my snapshots so my tests are no longer failing. But then yeah, I looked at the PR and it was like, why did you change that test? It was like, no goal for changing that test. It doesn't have any reason. So you can just check, okay, that value has changed, it's maybe logic. Or you can just say, hey, you didn't write tests for this logic. Maybe you should write tests. Also, tests should be deterministic. What we mean with deterministic, if I have the same inputs, I always expect the same outputs. So make your tests logic. If you have, for example, date.now, yeah, you know a date is always depending on the moment that you run the test. So just mock out the no function. We can predict the date. We predict what string will be returned on that moment. Also, test units of code, not methods. What we mean with units? I have, for example, a complex algorithm, but I have an input, an output, it's always the same, but for like code readability, I split it up in multiple functions or multiple blocks. But in fact, if I start a refactor, I'm only interested in the input and the output that remains the same. So if I tested each function separately, yeah, then I need to refactor my tests also. What should not be the case with the refactor. Expect if there is a bug into it, but it should not be the case. Also, like I said, ng test minus u, it's fun to run that. It updates your snapshots. But in the end, okay, it updates your snapshots. But do you want that your snapshots want to be updated? Like what I do sometimes for logging, and probably some of you also, I add, for example, data, pipe symbol, JSON, to see what's in my data object. Okay, I don't want to have this committed on my code, so that's one thing I expect my test changes, my test fails. So if I did ng test minus u, it will just update my tests. So be careful when you run this. Again, commit your snapshots. I cannot say it enough because, yeah, why should you run snapshots if you don't commit it? Everyone wants to use continuous integration to run their test and to make their builds hopeful, not failing. Another thing we need to do on our continuous integration tools, we need to be sure we run ng test or npm test or yarn test. It doesn't matter, but the command behind it should be ng test, not ng test minus u. Because again, it doesn't make sense if you put ng test minus u on this command. If you update each time your snapshot on your continuous integration tool, it will not fail again. And at the end, I would say everyone should start love testing and start testing because it gives a lot of value. And for sure, with Jest, it makes your life a bit easier. And I want to thank you again. I have my code on GitHub, and I will tweet my slides if you want to look at it. So thank you for today.